welcome everybody to our next Facebook Live from Adams County Extension. I'm Cassie Anderson. I manage the Master Gardener program in Adams County, and today I'm going to be here talking to you guys about setting up and installing a drip irrigation system and what you need to make sure that you're going to have success with your drip irrigation system. And that's going to be everything from the component parts to hints and tips of things that we've figured out that are helpful for us in terms of getting yourself started. I do have Barbara Carvalho here helping me out. She's going to help answer any questions that I have so that I don't have to type while I'm talking on my phone outside in this lovely weather that we're having. I hope everybody's had a little bit of a chance to get outside. I hope everyone's staying healthy and getting a little bit of time in your gardens. It's a great time to be thinking about putting an irrigation system in, especially in your vegetable gardens, but also in your perennial gardens. Drip irrigation is immensely useful for making sure that you stay really, really water wise, making sure that you're not wasting water. You can really focus your attention in on what gets watered. And that also helps with weed problems. If you're not just watering an entire area, then you're much more likely to have a lot of success in watering just what you need, just what you want. So, with that, I'm going to flip the camera back around. I've got a whole little lineup of things for us to talk about. I'm going to pull out my cheat sheet notes just so that I make sure that I keep kind of on track. Alright, so there's kind of two things that you need when you're setting up your irrigation system. You need to be able to connect to your spigot itself. I actually am on a well at my house, and so this is where all of my water comes from. If you're working with culinary water from your house, then your hose bib is going to be on your house itself. So you need to be able to connect this to all of this. And so to do that, the very first thing that you need is your backflow preventer, which is a little thing that looks like this. It's like $5 to $8 at the hardware store, and that's going to be the very first piece, and it actually is threaded, and so you can put it onto your hose spigot. So that is your very first piece that you need. I'm going to move a few of these out of the way so that we can talk about the pieces in a lineup. After your backflow preventer, you need your pressure regulator. Water comes out from the spigot on your house at a very specific rate, and a lot of the drip irrigation stuff works at a much lower pressure. So you need a pressure regulator. Next up, you need a filter. And that filter is going to just make sure that if there's any gunk in your water line or anything, that it gets filtered out and doesn't then clog up your much smaller drip line emitter areas. As I said, I'm on a well, so I actually have to clean my filters out pretty frequently because they do get clogged up with debris that gets shifted up from the well itself. So if you're working with culinary water, you're not as likely to need to do that, but it's something to be aware of. And then I don't have it here because it's out on my vegetable garden and in my other beds. You will need an adapter to make this connect to your half inch feeder tube. This is going to be kind of the mother line that feeds the water to your drip irrigation system. You can get an adapter that goes onto the end that connects it onto here. As you're figuring out how it lays out in the garden, you can get these pieces. They push on with pressure, but then they kind of clamp on. You can get them in all different, you can get T-post ones like this. You can get angled ones like this. So you can kind of really customize the shape. This is a little bit flexible, but if I hold this down, it's not super flexible and it will kink if you bend it too much. So having pieces like these is going to be very helpful for you to make sure that you get good shapes in your garden. If you have an angle or a bend, an elbow is going to give you a much better result than trying to kink your feeder tube around. The other thing on the end of these feeder tube, you want to make sure that the water just doesn't come straight out, so you can get little end pieces like this. You put it on and then you fold the tube and just slide this in and pull it up, and then that's going to seal off the end very well so that you don't get any leaks. Next up, you're going to need your spaghetti tubing. So this can be a solid tubing like this. This has been in the sun, so it's really supple. When it's cold, these things get really, really rigid. So if you can do your install on a warm day, it can be a really good idea because you're going to be able to have everything be just that little bit more malleable. So your fine feeder tubing can connect up. You can see this little piece on the end if it will focus. Pull it a little further away. There's all these little connector pieces. You can get them in a massive bag like this. Connectors for your quarter inch tubing. And that you can then plug in. Actually, I could even do it. Plug in to this piece. So to do that, there are a couple different tools. There's one like this. There's a smaller one which we used to have, which is another blue handle, and it's just straight, and it works just fine. This, if you're doing a lot, is a lot nicer. There's a spring in it, and so you're going to not have nearly as much hand fatigue. So all you do, you put that tubing in, squeeze, and you've made a hole. And then you can put that tubing, you can take that little piece and just push it in, and it's just plug and play, and it's ready to go. It's kind of astonishing how simple it can be, but really that's all there is to attaching these two pieces. And on the end of this solid spaghetti tubing, you can attach something like this sprayer, micro emitter sprayer. This particular one has a little nozzle, so you can adjust its flow, whether it's flowing really strongly or really, really slowly. You can also attach, I love this stuff. So this is the spaghetti tubing, but it has, every 6 inches on this one, it has inline emitters built into it. And those inline emitters are going to drip out at a set rate. The packaging is going to tell you what rate it is. Usually it's a 1/2 gallon, 1 gallon, or 2 gallon an hour kind of rate. And so you can buy it in different sizes. You can find this at the big box stores. You can also find it at plumbing supply houses. And you can find it anywhere from 6-inch spacing all the way up to 18-inch spacing, depending on what your needs are. And so it can be really useful to kind of have that. You can spread it out in your garden, and it just gives you really good uniform coverage. I have it in a lot of my perennial beds so that I don't get too much water, but I have some nice moisture. If you don't want to go that route, you can use this solid spaghetti tubing, and you can put micro emitters on. They make these little micro emitters that have that little spike on the end of it as well, and some of them, this one is adjustable. You can actually twist it so that you can get differing level amounts of water, and they'll usually tell you the range on the packaging from 1/2 gallon to 3 gallons an hour or something like that. And so you can put those little micro emitters on. So that can be useful. You can also get micro emitters that look like this. I put these on like my tomato crops or my pepper crops so that I get good steady moisture on them. So this guy is going to be another option. And you would put that solid line emitter tube on that. And you can daisy chain them. So if you look, I've actually got these, might be a little hard to see. We've got these, this is two of them that then would connect into that mother tubing. So you don't have to have them all together. If you are using like this inline emitter, it's fairly often the best if you can take your black line and you actually loop it, and you do a run that goes back to it so that you've got a closed loop. That closed loop is going to get you the very best pressure and the very best overall system. If you're like me and you're doing a lot of different things, you might want to think about having a splitter so that you have a lot of different controls. These are nice because you've got valves that you can turn on and off, but you can do it in line with your half-inch mother tubing as well. You can get a valve like this that you just twist off and twist on. And they're pretty simple. They stand up really well. I've got some in my garden that have been there for 3 or 4 years already. If you do start getting all of this done and you realize that you've got a leak somewhere or something wasn't where you want it, you can buy, let's see, I think I've got them in here, you can buy Goof Plugs. That's literally what they're called. These guys will pop into a hole that you've put into your half-inch tubing, and then you can start over. You don't have to, you can plug that hole up. So it's not the end of the world if you make a hole and realize that you made a mistake. The last piece that I have to show, if you're working with the inline emitter and you've got a little bit of a leak, you can get these clamps that will kind of snug everything down around your attachments. It's not going to be so necessary for something like your T-adjuster, but we do use them in our garden when we're using something like this, just to give it a little bit of extra security so that it doesn't leak too much. So that's kind of a basic rundown of the basics that you need to get yourself started, and everything's now nice and condensed right around me, to get yourself started for a drip irrigation setup. Oh, no, there's one more thing. There is also this soaker hose spaghetti tubing, which I think, if you can kind of see, this just has many, many micro pores in it. And it's just going to send out a lot of very, very low pressure water through all around the area and all along the entire line. And so that can be useful for something if you really need it to get wet or to stay nice and moist, but you don't want to soak it fast and furious. It's a nice slow option. Say that you get your whole setup done and you've got everything figured out. You do need to be able to keep things in line. You can get these little spikes that actually do hook on to your spaghetti tubing. See if I can do this one-handed. I cannot. They're a little hard to get on. There we go. So you can actually put that little spike on the tube and then you can stick it into the ground and it will keep your tubing where you want it. There's a bunch of different types of this that you can buy. I've got some metal just loop ones that go over the half-inch emitter and they work well. But being able to keep things snugly firmed into the ground is going to be nice. That way things don't get kicked around and you don't miss your water where you need it. We do have a very good fact sheet that hopefully Barbara can look up on drip irrigation, which we can put in the comments either now or later. And that's got a lot of details and information about how you can kind of set things up. I strongly recommend that you have some containers that you keep all of these materials in the off season so that you don't have to go scrounging all over the house for all the different places that you've put them. And generally speaking, you want to make sure that things that you're going to reuse from season to season like this are fully well drained before you unplug them and that they're nice and cleaned out, as I see a bunch of stuff coming out of this one because it's been used for several seasons. I can actually prop this up and I will show you that you can actually open this up and you can clean that filter out. You can see that it's not exactly nice and white. We have a lot of mineral material in our soils, or in our water here, and so. But that's what that filter is. You can pull it out, you can clean it out, and you can reuse it. All right, and then the one final thing, when you're using drip irrigation, especially in your own, thank you, Barbara. When you're using drip irrigation in a vegetable garden, You want a good uniform coverage over the top, so something like this, in addition to your drip system, for getting seeds started can be very beneficial. So although there's a lot of benefits to the drip system, it can be problematic for seed starting or for very specific, for broadcast uses. All right, we do have a question. Do we set up a new system each year and we remove it each fall? Generally speaking, with all of these materials, these are safe to keep out in the yard each year. So in my perennial beds, they are going to stay there until I notice that they are starting to fail and need replacing, which can be years instead of, it can be multiple years before you need to start replacing. You do want to check out your drip system from year to year and make sure that all of your drippers are still dripping and that they are watering effectively. They can get clogged over time. I mean, if you look, this is a tiny little thing. If it's going to focus, there we go. It's very tiny, and we have a lot of minerals in our soil, and so they can get clogged over time. But that's one of the nice things of these being kind of a DIY set project, is that you can take this one off and then you could put a goof plug in that hole and you can put a new one in a hole right near it, or on some spaghetti tubing right near it. Or if you've got your spaghetti tubing and this guy has plugged up, all you do is you can take a nice pair of shears. These are pretty much exclusively for our drip system. Cut off the tip and then you can just plug that guy right in. And it takes a little bit of pressure and a little bit of force. It's not super smooth, but you want it to be nice and snug so that you get good sealing so that the water all comes out of here and not out of here. All right, I think that is about it. If you have any other questions, you can definitely let us know. Master Gardeners are answering emails through Remote Help Desk on Monday, Wednesday, and Fridays. And we are always available via email. We can put my email address in the chat here once I've wrapped this up as well, if there are not any other questions. All right, sounds good. Thank you guys so much, and we will see you again on Friday for a talk on Intro to Xeriscaping, and we will be back next week with a new topic that we haven't quite figured out yet. So if you have any other ideas of things that you want to see in this series, definitely let us know and we will try and make it happen. Thanks so much and have a great rest of your day.